Well, what's up, everybody? How you doing? Dave Fennoy here. Another Wednesday, another Ask Dave Fennoy Anything. It is 6 p.m. Pacific, and I don't know where you are watching from. Maybe you're on Facebook, which last week for some reason wasn't working. Maybe you're on Twitter. Maybe you are on LinkedIn. And maybe you're watching on YouTube, where all the Ask Dave Fennoy Anythings live. So if there's one you heard about because you missed it, but you want to get it, you can go to my YouTube channel, Dave Fennoy Voiceover Training, and kind of scroll through and find what you're looking for. And just because, I'm going to take a minute to say hello to some people while I take care of some other business. A reminder that VO Atlanta is coming up. I'll be there. I'm doing two X sessions. I've got a breakout session. I'll be on a couple of panels, the BIPOC panel, the video game panel, and I've just been asked to be on the confidence panel. We'll be talking about confidence with some of the most confident voiceover actors in the world that I'll be on stage with, and that'll be a whole lot of fun. And let me see, we got Terry, what's going on, man? And followed by Terry Nicole and Grace Newton, you were first up. And Stacy, the Walking Dead game fan. You know, I'm not doing this for the fans, but I really appreciate the fans that will show up every week. And if you ask the right question and I see it, I'll try to answer some of your fan questions today. Let's see. I mentioned that, the BIPOC. I mentioned that, the X session. So let's get on with this. My guest today, well, let me just bring her on. And there she is. Ladies and gentlemen, Miss Galena White. How are you?
I am absolutely wonderful, Dave.
Oh, turn your microphone up just a little. Oh, maybe I can turn you up a little bit here. Yeah, I can bring you up. Yeah, that's probably better. One more time.
I am wonderful. How's that?
That is wonderful, wonderful. Good to see you.
Thank you. It's good to be seen, and it's great to see you.
Yeah, and now you got in touch with me when I asked you to be a part of this, and you were like, why me? And you were so nervous, and there's no need to be nervous. We are just having a conversation mostly about you and your career. And one of the reasons I thought of you is because I see you at every convention, and we're going to talk about conventions, and you have something that you're working on to help people with conventions, but we'll get to that. Let's wind back to the beginning of your career. How did you get involved in voiceover? What was the path that led you here?
Okay, so I actually love this story. So I'm a teenager, and one night I went out with some friends. I was attending a drama performing arts school, taking drama and stage management. And I go out to a club one night with some friends, and it was an amazing night. And I almost didn't go to school the next day, but I loved my school. It was a very small school. We only had 200 people. Mm-hmm. And I did, like I said, drama and stage management. And then we had music and we had dance. And so anyway, this night was so amazing with my friends. I almost didn't go to school, but I was like, I love my school. I love my, you know, everything. I'm just going to go to school. I was so exhausted. Well, it just so happens that a producer from the BBC was there to give us a impromptu audition for a radio show they were doing. We had no idea they were going to attend. And had I not shown up that day, I wouldn't have attended. And then I won the spot for a radio drama called Comfort Herself.
Oh, my goodness.
And that was my start into VO. I didn't even know what VO was. I wanted to be on stage. My career mindset was I was, you know.
So you were in high school at this time?
No, I was in a college.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
The way we have our school system in London is kind of different. But yeah, I was in a college at this time.
Yeah. I'm going to tell a story about myself and the first black Brit that I met. This is going back to the 80s, and my consciousness was, I wasn't thinking about anything about black British people. I knew we were in Jamaica, I knew we were in Africa, I knew we were here. And I was going to get on the bus, and there was this beautiful sister standing at the bus stop, and I had to say hello. And I walked up, got myself together. "Hey, how you doing? My name's Dave. You ride this bus all the time?" "Oh, hello, how are you?" Nice. Up until that point, silly me, I had no idea that we were there too. But I guess we're all over the world, so. Are you first generation or second generation, third generation?
So I'm first generation. My family actually is from Ghana, West Africa. I'm the only one in my immediate family that was born in London. So yeah, I'm first generation, I guess,
All
African.
right. All right. You know what? At some point, I got to talk to you about some African dishes.
Oh.
I collect African art. I have a great collection of masks and furniture and batiks and mud cloth and kuba cloth and whatnot. I love all things African. I've got some ancient Egyptian stuff.
Oh my.
And
I love ancient Egyptian everything.
yeah. Cool,
Yeah.
cool, cool. Anyway, enough of that. So you're in college. You went to a party. And you thought about not going to school, but you went and you auditioned and you got this job. What was this job exactly?
So it was a radio drama show from a book called Comfort Herself. And it was about a little mixed race girl and just her struggles moving from her home. And yeah, so anyway, that led to other radio shows and just other opportunities with stage and performance of all kinds, yeah.
Yeah, so when you sent me pictures, there was a stage production. It looked like it was a musical theater, was it?
It was. So in 2017, my son and I, my older son Isaiah and I debuted in a stage show. We did Hairspray and I was Motor Mouth Maybelle. And that was at a local theater here where I live.
Okay, so winding back again. So you got that show, you got some other shows from that. Were you really taking voiceover seriously at that time, or was there another spark that lit the flame that got you where you're in your studio now and I can see the foam and the 416? So you obviously have good equipment. We'll talk about that in a bit. But when did you really start to take voiceover seriously?
So actually, I didn't take voiceover very seriously at that time. Drama and stage was where I really wanted to go, I thought. And then I took a trip to America and met this boy, and he was adorable. Liked him a lot and ended up marrying him.
And that's your handsome husband.
That's my handsome husband.
There you go. There you go.
And so when I married him, I left London and came to Virginia's where we lived for about 4.5 years. And things were really different, and I tried the whole real job thing in corporate. And then when we had our first son, Isaiah, we moved to Texas of all places. And then I became a full-time stay-at-home mom. So during that whole time from my move to America to having my son and my other son and raising him, I was kind of completely out of all performance. I was 100% on my kids, and just kind of left that to the wayside for a bit. And then I kind of, the internet was starting to come up at that time. I kind of looked around looking for some regular groups or local groups, and I found a group headed by somebody called Cliff Zellman. So,
Ah, Cliff's going to be on next week, by
oh, okay. Well, so I kind of reached out to him, and at that time he was having a meetup every month, I believe it was, and I would attend a couple and
way. Now,
try to check.
Cliff was is in Texas.
Yes, he is. He's in Texas. That's where I am now too.
Ah, okay.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know why I thought you were in jolly old England. I thought you were in London still, but no, you're living here now.
Yes, now I'm living here. I
Okay.
waved goodbye and I came over.
But followed your man.
I did. So then, long story short, Cliff became my mentor, and he has been everything for me. He would just meet me whenever I would ask. No matter how many times I would call him, he would always respond to me, go to lunch, just give me, just all this stuff. And then one day we had a group lunch, and he was like, "Hey, you should go to VO Atlanta." I was like, "What's VO Atlanta?" He was like, "Go, just do it." Well, I trusted him completely with my life. So I started looking it up and I was like, "Okay, well, I don't know what this is. I don't know what's going on, but I wanna volunteer." So I signed up to be a volunteer. Gerald was had VO Atlanta at that time, and I became a volunteer that first year, and everything was just new and big and wild. And I was like, this is where I'm supposed to be. This is what I'm supposed to do. And the experience just left me kind of like an addict.
Oh,
And
I actually can't. I actually can't understand that. I'm a voiceover addict myself. Yeah, I need some copy. Where's the microphone?
the shakes when you don't get it,
Yeah. And if I have a couple of days where I haven't had auditions or bookings or something, like, is my phone still working? Is the email?
Yeah. Am I in the Twilight Zone?
So you're going to be at this year's VO Atlanta.
I am.
And when we were talking beforehand, you just happened to mention that you are working on a program to help people take advantage of conventions. Now,
Absolutely.
when you told me that, I immediately thought, oh, well, she's perfect because you see Galena at every convention. She is friends with everybody. She knows everybody. She is a bright, shining light of joy whenever you see her. She must be doing something right. So tell me about this new adventure of yours.
I went to VO Atlanta again, and I met this lady named Terry Nicole, and she does e-learning. And so I attended her X session. And so we got to talking at the end of it and kind of connected and bonded in a way. So we were just talking about, life and everything else. And one day it just kind of came to us about creating a course about conferences, because I had attended a number of them by that time, and I like to volunteer, I like to help, so I kind of get both ends of being at a conference, behind the scenes a little bit, in front of the scenes, and just showing up. And so I remember my experience, what I was thinking, what I didn't know, how overwhelmed I felt. I remember at the time it was big, and each year just got bigger and bigger. And now VO Atlanta is the biggest
That's the biggest
convention in
voiceover
the
conference in the world.
world. In the world. And so it sold out numbers. And so it's been such an amazing experience for me, that growth. I've been able to really connect with people and nurture relationships and friendships, and so many benefits have come, and I want to share that with people, because There is so many new people coming in every day that don't know what to do.
Yeah.
And I want to make sure that, you know, conferences are not always friendly to the pocket. And so how do you get your
money's worth? Get more bang for your buck.
How do you do that? How do you show up to a conference and actually get what your investment is? I don't want people walking away from something and saying, you know, this was a waste. I didn't get what I needed out of this. And a conference is a lot. It's too much sometimes. And, you know, you have to take care of yourself. You have to take care of your well-being in order to be able to get everything
well,
that's
let's,
coming out.
Well, let's talk about that. How do you take care of your well-being? We have so many genres of voiceover now. How do you decide what X sessions, breakout sessions, other sessions that you want to go to? How do you maneuver that? How does one, you know, for me, I've always been on the other side. When I started going to conferences, I was a speaker, a presenter, teaching at conferences. Because when I was coming along in the 90s, early 2000s, they didn't have these conferences. What's the mistake people make? And what should a person do to get the most out of that conference? I have questions like, well, should you try looking at sessions that are not in your wheelhouse or stick with things that you're working on now? How do you make friends? How do you overcome being shy? Teach.
So first and foremost, a really good conference would have prepared you for the conference, especially if you're on social media. If you're on social media, they would have told you what their schedule is, what their lineup is. Their lineup will explain, will have a bio, a short bio of who these speakers are, what they're representing. And so before you even get to the conference, you have to start your homework. So look at that schedule. Your schedule is your Bible for a conference. This is where you can choose what genres you're into. If you don't know of a genre, like maybe audio description. What is audio description? Well, when you read the schedule,
because it's new. Audio description is one of the newest areas.
Audio description is new and people might not be familiar. So in order to see if that's something that could be, you could be absolutely perfect for it, read your schedule, get to know who these presenters are, find them online, follow them online, and then kind of get a feel as to, okay, do you want to do commercials? Are you more animation? Are you medical? You know, what is it that you have in your life that you're interested in? And then always, whatever you include, I would suggest you include a business course of something to help you know how to navigate your business, because it's not just about performing.
That is so true. And I know a lot of us who are kind of old school had the union agent route. Those aren't things that we had to know. We didn't have to know how to put together a studio at that time. And most of us, we counted on our agents. We'd do some promotion ourselves, but our agents would provide us, say, with broadcast producers or people in the promo world that we could send our demos to. But we weren't doing the kind of promotion for ourselves that needs to happen now. There weren't the kinds of jobs. We weren't doing as much of the various kinds of narration and e-learning and corporate nair and so forth that we were out looking for these jobs. You really have to be not only a voice actor, but an entrepreneur.
Yes. Yes, you absolutely do. And the performance of VO is what why you got into it. You love to perform, you love to create with your body. But in order to have a successful business, you need to know the business. And so conferences give you all the tools that you need. And in the course that Terry and I are working on together, we explain how to, get all that information that you're getting and how to make sense of it, because there's a lot coming at you. And if you're, if you have any type of brain like me where it's all over the place and spaghetti, I need help categorizing things. And that will, we'll have resources and it will be an interactive course. It's not just a click and play. And we also have lots of amazing people that we have interviewed on there. And you will be also featured on there. And so, yes.
Speaking of Terry Nicole, well, there she is. Is that's your Terry Nicole, isn't it?
That is my Terry
All
Nicole,
right.
yes.
And she says Ghana is incredible. This is earlier, your family's from Ghana. And Galena can cook. Well, I know we're a little off topic here, but what do you cook, Galena?
So I can cook. We call it draw stew, egusi, bangku, fufu, jollof rice, all kinds of, those are the African dishes I can cook, some of them. And then, I can just cook stuff. So
Well, you know the
I was raised knowing how to cook.
talking about that, the VO Trio might want to get you on their show and do a Terry Briscoe segment. He always does a menu, or not a menu. He always does a recipe, and you might want to stand in for him one day. And I know he's there listening. So Terry, nee, 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 nee. Speaking of Terry, Galena, how do you plan breaks in without missing out on the great stuff at a conference?
Okay, so when you've checked out your schedule, and you've delved a little bit into the conference, you'll know if they have replays or if they don't. VO Atlanta, they do have replays, options for to replay. So take a look at your weekend and what your main focus is. Choose like at least three main genres, I would say, to cover various things. And what you'll find with conferences as big as VO Atlanta is that they have multiple time slots for these subject matters, or you'll have multiple people that are talking something similar. So either way, when you go through that schedule, you'll be able to see who's teaching what at what time, what day, and then you can plan it out. You can get your own little book, or we'll have a workbook available at the course. And you can just go through and just write down, okay, this day I want to focus on these topics, and these are the people that is teaching this. This is the breakouts I need to be at.
Yeah, I think the biggest problem is not so much planning your day, but not trying to do all the parties at night. But you can't do them all. You got to pace
No.
yourself. You got to pace
Pace
yourself.
yourself.
Let's
Drink
see.
lots of water, be hydrated, pace yourself.
Venus Crute, hey, beautiful Galena White. So nice to you on Ask Dave Fennoy. I think she was said some other words in there. So nice to see you, I think is what she was going to say on Ask Dave Fennoy. I need a little AI thing that fills stuff in. It's interesting because everybody knows you. Everybody knows you because you have put yourself front and center. Were you shy the first time you went to a conference?
So I constantly have stage fright. I would say I am an extroverted introvert. So I get very nervous. I really do. You would never know it. I get very nervous. And for me personally, I tell myself, what is the end game of what I want? And how do I get it? It's by meeting people. I have to meet people, so I have to overcome my fears. But because at the same time I enjoy people, I enjoy being, how I am. I won't say it's the easiest thing, but it's not, I'm not crippled by it. I prefer to have the company of people, so I will overcome that little stage fright, that 5 seconds, 10 seconds of stage fright, and just go for it, and hopefully not fall on my face.
Well, just like we want to improve our skills in voiceover, so much of the improvement that we need is the improvement of who we are as human beings. How can we be kinder, more open, help more people, overcome limitations we may feel we have? Because if we keep telling ourselves, "Oh, I'm shy, I can't talk to anybody," that's what we will be. And sometimes you think, okay, well, this is how I am now, but let me take some steps and step out. Sometimes you have to step out even though you are a bit in fear. And for those who are going and might feel like, "I don't know if I could talk to people, I don't know." Those of us who are presenters and whatnot, we are there to say hello. We are there to help you. We are there to share information. And we're just regular human beings, y'all. We really are. I don't know of any real prima donnas in voiceover who would show up to be a presenter to talk to people and not talk to people. We're like everybody else. Got a big one from Terry Briscoe here. Very true about the business, and tech is in there as well. Absolutely. And we'll talk about your tech in just a bit. I always make sure to find my way into a class that teaches those areas as well. Performing is great, but you got to have someone to perform for and the knowledge to make that performance shine when it's time to deliver the recordings. Absolutely. And speaking of which, your studio, your equipment, who helped you with that, as if I didn't know?
So, I mean, I started off, very humble. My very first microphone that I got, I actually won at VO Atlanta. And I had my closet. I was working out of my closet, and then I just happened to go on eBay, and somebody was selling a whisper room about 4 hours from me. So my husband and I rented a U-Haul, and we drove to Arkansas. We picked up the booth, we drove on back, put it together ourselves, and then Cliff, my mentor, helped me to, tell me what I needed, to treat it. He came and did all the wonderful things for me and told me all the stuff that I needed to get. And I got the Focusrite Scarlett here. I eventually, it took a while, but I finally got my
You're 416.
Yes,
You know, it's
it took a while.
interesting. I used to hear a lot of women tell me they didn't like the 416. "Oh, my voice doesn't sound good on it." I always wondered about that because I believe it's one of the best mics because it's made for the voice. It's made for TV and movies and getting dialogue. It's very directional. It'll help you with noise in your studio. And it's made to record voices.
I
Yeah.
like it.
Oh, I have a mic collection, and most of them are collecting dust. In my studio, I can switch between my 416 and I have a TLM 103 also, and I switch those out from time to time. I can push a button and just swing one in. But 99% of the time, it's the 416 no matter what. Oh, got a quick hello here. Portia Scott says, "Yay, Galena! Woo-hoo!"
So Porsche is my agent.
Oh, there you go. Portia is a good agent. We are very good friends. I love her dearly. There are times I went, "I wish I could have her as an agent too," but she's probably a better friend for me. So, how soon is this book, this course, going to come out?
So, it will co we don't have a date yet. We had a few delays. Life threw us some lemons and we
Well, I
kind of
imagine
dodged
that.
them, but we kind of, got hit in the head a bit, so we had to delay it. We were hoping to have it by Via Atlanta. But right now we have a pre-sale. And we also have our early adopters that have been the best early adopters in the world. Hi, if you're out there, who are just helping us to make sure that everything is great and, typos, blah, blah, blah. So that it's available for pre-sale. We should be dropping at least the first chapter shortly after VO Atlanta.
Now,
What do you think?
so these early adopters, these folks, are they kind of taking the course and then giving you feedback about what they think is working and not working?
Exactly,
Okay.
exactly. So they're helping
And
us put it.
what's the scope of it? How where does it live? Is it all written? Is it all online? Are there videos and audio? What's the
So right now,
experience of it?
so we have this program where it's living right now. I don't know what it's, I think it's called Thinkific. It's a course builder platform. So we do have videos. We've already interviewed a number of conference organizers, and we've gotten some perspectives on what it is to put on a conference, why their conference is different or special, or what it is that they bring to the table to the industry that is needed. We've interviewed a number of regular attendees, and we have additional organizers that have agreed to be interviewed, and Cliff was interviewed, so JMC was interviewed. So we have some heavy hitters on here that will really give you some, not just, hey, attend, it's wonderful, but will give you some really great insight to how to build your business, how to navigate the conference, to build your career, to uplift your career. Because there is a wrong way, and well, not a wrong way, but there are ways that you can go about a conference that is maybe not the best things to do. And there's a best way to go, navigate through a conference.
Got a question here from Richelieu Hoff Jr. Is recording of panels okay? Can you pull out your phone and record?
You would have to find out from each conference. Each conference is different. I believe for the most part, I'm not too sure. You would have to ask the tech.
That's a very good question. I think it's frowned upon to record it. Often there are cameras, they have their own cameras and they are recording. And maybe you wouldn't get all the visuals, but you set your phone there, turn the little recorder on and get all the sound possibly. But
They do have
I would check with the conference.
And they do not all of them, not all conferences do, but a lot of conferences they do offer replays.
Oh, there you go. There you go.
So
And
whatever you'll be able to catch on the replay.
Luana Dyer, it's not a question. She just says every room is always brighter when Galena steps in.
Appreciate
And
it.
you know what? It is so true. You really are a bright light. You just bring a wonderful energy with you, and everybody just loves you. You're always smiling. You've got a joke. You got a hug. You got a laugh. Let's see.
I like to feel good. And apparently my name actually means torchlight. So
Ah, you know, I was going to ask you what did Galena mean, and I thought, that's probably a silly question. Means torchlight.
No,
Okay. Okay.
it's a great question. It means torch or
Yeah,
light.
Venus Crute. Hey, beautiful Galena White. So nice to see you on Ask Dave Fennoy. Hey, Dave. Love you both. Oh, Venus, thank you
Thanks,
so much.
Venus. It's good to see you. Thank you.
Michael Sessom. If you can only go to one conference, ooh, good question. Which would you recommend, or is the best for the money?
So what I would say to that is it really depends on you. You as an individual, right now, VO Atlanta had, last year they had over 1,000 attendees. And so are you somebody that enjoys 1,000 other individuals that you can learn from with, partner together with? Or are you somebody that is a little more intimate? You would like something a little smaller, because crowds is not your jam. So then you would want to look at other conferences that I could name, that are a little smaller. And then you would want to see what that conference is pushing the most, what their theme is. Is it just a gaming conference, or is it a free-for-all conference? Is it just a business conference? So it just depends on how you are as an individual, what you're looking for, where you envision your business to be, and what interests you. So yes. But I would absolutely say you have to go to VO Atlanta, because there's so much to learn,
Well, look who's popped in here, Cliff Zellman, my guest next week, your mentor. And he says, you had friends that pushed you out there.
Oh, 100%, because fear is a real thing. It is an invisible blanket that envelops you and can really hold you back. And your friends are the ones that are really going to support you, push you, lift you up when you're down, bring you along, love on you. Friends are everything, and you'll find your tribe, you'll find your people at these conferences you go to.
You
That's
know,
what I go for. It's therapy for me.
it's interesting because often when I'm talking to people getting into voiceover, I tell them, look, you want to get in the community because those are truly the only people who know what you're going through, who have the experience. And it's a very solitary, hobo-like existence. These days, we're all at home in our home studios waiting on auditions to come in and jobs to come in that we are doing from home. So getting to these conferences give you an opportunity to meet your tribe and chill with your tribe and learn from your tribe, because your mama, your daddy, your girlfriend, your boyfriend, your wife, your husband, they don't know what you're going through. It's you can't explain what's happening, why you need to do this and why you need to do that, and why you can't go out to lunch today because your agent said there might be an audition coming through and so forth and so on. You need people who understand and will celebrate your victories and commiserate when things aren't going so well. Short story, when I first came to LA, I learned about voiceover workout groups. And I had been taking lessons and classes, and I was running out of money. And I said, well, oh, those workout groups. Well, let me get a few people from this agency, from this agency. And there's about 10 of us. And we would meet up every couple of weeks at somebody's house and critique one another on our reads. And one, everybody in that group went on to do very well. So it's a very good thing to do. But I discovered something that I hadn't realized was going to happen. That first 10, 20 minutes when we're all just gathering, having snacks, a cup of coffee, and talking, we got to talk about, gee, I'm afraid my agent's going to let me go. Gee, I haven't booked anything. And he had somebody to commiserate and advise that's not caught up in the emotion of it. And when something good happened for you booked that thing, you got that contract, you had someone that understood how much that meant to you, and really could celebrate with you. And I really want to say, celebrate with your friends. I always feel like when friends of mine book something great, I'm close to it.
Yeah.
Because I'm friends with that person. I'm in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
And you're going to get yours. You're going to get yours.
It's there.
It's
waiting
there.
For you.
Waiting for you. Got a question here from Lyle McCarty. With your English accent, do you find your voice to be more, now I'm slipping into to be more marketable and in demand in various other countries outside of England? For example, do you have clients in African countries, Great Britain and the USA?
I do. And being African, I can do the African accent, so that's helpful. Woo-hoo. I do have clients outside of the US, in London, you know. There's different styles of British accent. It's not just one accent.
There's like 30 just in London alone.
Yeah, we do. So, it's easy for us Brits to be able to navigate through all of those. And so it's, you know, with everything else, it's a challenge, you know, a lot of people, they will like the voice and say, hey, this is perfect because it's so different, but then sometimes it's too different. So, you know, it hasn't just been like, oh, great, this is amazing. You know, it's been a little bit, and some industries are like, oh, that's, yeah. So, you know, it's just like with everything else, you just get whatever client likes you, you do your best. I try to work on all different types of accents to, you know.
How often are you working in your American accent?
I would probably say maybe 20 to 30% is American.
Okay, and how much work? What's the percentage of work? And you're gonna guess. I would never be able to tell you that. But what percentage of work is in the United States for the United States?
The majority, actually. Most of my clients here in America. So whoop whoop, thank you, clients. I appreciate you.
All right, there.
Yeah, and, you know, I do have some clients in Dubai, and, you know, quite various different places. I have a client in Australia, but most of my clients are in America, American clients. They like me.
And now, are you doing most of that in your British accent?
I am. Most of it is British. They, you know, they prefer.
So, oh, you Brits, you learn our accents. You do your own, you come over here and you take our work. Jesus.
I've heard that too.
Oh, boy.
So then I just put on the worst American accent ever. And I'm like, I'm not a threat.
let me hear your worst American accent.
So I was walking down the street over there and saw Grandpa.
Oh yeah, that's please, no more. It's pretty bad. It's bad.
Are you
it's
sure terrible. I've got more?
Oh no, that's enough. But you know what? I wouldn't be surprised if that could work on some crazy cartoon or something. Anyway. DF Raisin, the parties last year at VO Atlanta were a blast, but I definitely needed an extra day to recoup. I gotta raise my hand there.
You have to definitely pace yourself. You know, if you need a moment, take a moment. You know, take a breather. Find your you time as well. But absolutely, partying is necessary.
Oh, yeah. We got to let the steam out from all year. Haven't seen y'all since. All right. Grace Newton, Galena at VO Atlanta last year. Cliff showed me your video game demo. I didn't know you had a video game demo. I didn't see it on your website. That he produced
it. If you go down, it's a video. It's the YouTube video. So you'll actually get to see it.
All right. A video game demo that he produced, and it is amazing. A video game genre. Is that one you especially like?
So I do like it. I haven't booked a bunch. I want to. But yeah, it's my jam. I like it. I like to play. I like to move around and, you know, with my range. Yeah, I enjoy it.
Well, let me ask you, are you getting the auditions for video games?
I am getting auditions for video games, yes.
What do you think's happening that you're not booking as many games as you'd like?
So at first it was the what I realized was, you know, the realism of it. You know, it's not just the words, it's actually pulling the words off the line and you know, putting life to it. And so I've been taking various classes. The last class that I took was with Andrea Toyas. Oh
Andrea's
my God.
great. Andrea's great. She is one of the best directors in the business. I've worked with her a lot. Yeah. I can't fault you from working with her.
She really, you know, I've been really, she opened my eyes to really, you know, going deeper into my
The
performance.
character. I tell my students, look, it's not about the words. It's about the
Right.
character in this moment in
Or the
time.
voice.
Or the voice. Yeah, no, it's not about the voice. It's do you think about how you're going to say what you're going to say in real life before you say it? No, you are thinking a certain thing, feeling a certain way, talking to a certain person with whom you have a relationship, and doing some. Maybe you're eating or walk. Those are the things you really got to count on. Because your body
Right.
informs your voice, you do all those things, out it comes.
Right. And if you know, that's such a valuable point, the body, you know, especially if you are from, you know, if you're a dancer, if you're into movement, you know, bringing that movement into your read makes such a difference. And that, I think that was missing a lot for me
Well,
before.
a lot of us are standing at the microphone and we're trying to do it like this. And that's not how we talk. That's not how
Right.
we communicate. We communicate with everything, our eyes, our mouth, the look on our faces, where our head is placed. If we have a disability and we're walking a little funny, if we're swinging something, if we're not really paying attention, we're just doing this thing over here. All of those things come into play. So, yeah, got to say the words, be familiar with the words, but play the character, react, think, feel, do, relationship.
Yeah. So that's what I'm working on. I'm realizing it was like night and day, and I was like, oh, okay. So I'm, you know, it's okay to breathe. You know, if I'm gonna sigh, I gotta sigh. If, you know, if I said something horrible, you know, there's a reaction before, during, after, you know, there's a whole lot that goes into. So I was like, okay.
Yeah, there's an old saying. Got to get in my teaching a little bit here too. There's an old saying that acting happens in between the lines. Often, if we're reading lines, we're trying not to pause. Oh, let me get that. Oh, yes, the next line. The words are calling me.
Yeah.
But in real life, there's a little bit of time we take to think, to react. A new thought jumps into our head and takes us in a different direction. You've got to allow for that, and that's where the acting really does happen. It's not how we say the words, it's all the other things. And then, as my friend Mark Esdale would say, the words, the speaking, that is the exhaust of the acting engine.
Right.
All
Love
right,
that.
let's see. Portia. Come on, Dave. Yeah, you know I had to get it in. I had to get it in. Claire Dinsdale. Now, I don't know if she's responding to me or you, but I also noticed in the promo I did, you got a picture with Claire. Else.
I have such a cute story about that picture. So we're at
Uh-oh. Well, you
service
know what?
together.
Let's get that story.
Okay, so we're at service together. We go together with Venus and a lovely lady that I met there called Leslie Ann. And there's this long line, and I had no idea that it was for, you know, award winners that was, you know, taking pictures. So we're standing there, and of course, you know, Claire is, you know, I believe she was nominated. So I'm standing next to her and we're talking, and then we kind of got shoved into, you know, the backdrop there. And then I realized I wasn't supposed to be there. So I turned around and then somebody had taken that picture. And I was like, hey, well, I might as well.
Hey, you know.
But then yep. I couldn't actually go to get the real picture with, you know, with the, which was fine. But I was like, okay, I like this one. It was cute.
Yeah, but that picture will live forever. And the story that'll be told decades from now. Yes, Galena was one of the winners of that award, standing with another winner. Got one from Elsie.
I'm going to be in with Claire.
There you go. Elsie Brodus, wonderful energy you have, Galena. Are folks still able to volunteer? Any spots for limited mobility? Very good question, Elsie. Because I think sometimes people want to go, and one of the best ways to get benefit is to go and help.
I'm not sure when the cutoff is for volunteers, but Dave, if you could get her name for me, I will find that.
Elsie Brodus.
Elsie. Okay, Elsie, I will find that information for you. Also, your second question about mobility.
We can just bring it back. Wonderful energy. Are folks still able to volunteer? Any spots for limited mobility?
Okay, so I'm not 100% sure about if there are any spots still available, but I will find that out for you, and I will get back to you on that. And any spots for limited mobility?
I'm going to say yes. Any public building where something like this is going on, there have to be ramps. There have to be has to be room to get in and out of a room in a wheelchair. There are elevators if you have to go up and down stairs. So I will just say yes. Mobility will be considered.
And in VO Atlanta, I believe most of the conference is on one level.
One floor, yeah. Yeah.
But we do, yeah, they do have elevators too.
But so you have to be able to get up to somebody's room for those crazy parties. I won't mention any names who shows up with a bag of booze and lights and almost got kicked out of the hotel last year. It wasn't me, but I was there. It's Mac Lewis. Now there's a name. What are your thoughts on voice actors marketing themselves to casting folks at VO Atlanta?
I mean, 100% you have to market yourself, and casting is who you want to market to. 100%. Absolutely. When you look in your schedule and you have the list of all of those speakers and presenters, they want to be contacted by you. They're looking for you. And so you can search them. You can find out their contact information or how they like to be communicated with. And absolutely introduce yourself when you get there. Say, hey, you know, I've followed you on blah, blah, blah. This is, you know, I'm, you know, taking your class, and you know, this was a great class, this was wonderful. They want to talk to you. Those are the ones that you want to market to. You don't want to market to other voice actors. You want to market to casting directors. Just don't bombard them and just be like, hey, you know, only me you can talk to, don't talk to anybody else but me.
Give them some room, especially if it's somebody that got a lot of people around them that want to talk, which is exactly what happens at the end of every presentation. And something I'm going to say, yeah, sure, give them your card, but make sure you get theirs.
Every year
that I go, a bunch of people want to hand, oh, here, let me give you my card. That's fine, but get mine. You're trying to get in touch with me or somebody like me. And I come home with a fistful of cards, and you didn't have your picture on it, or even if you did, I may not have remembered that, you know, 30-second conversation. The people you want to get in touch with, make sure you get their contact information and get in touch with them. And don't be surprised if they don't get right back to you 5 minutes after you've contacted them. People are busy. I know I am. Often it's two or three touches before let me get back to this person. And develop a relationship. You can do that very easily. A little bit about you. Find out something about them. Comment on things that you know they are doing, which means you've done a little bit of research. You are interested in them as a human being, not just a vehicle to your success.
Right. 100%.
All right. Terry Nicole, do you feel you can get a good experience from virtual conferences? Oh, good question, Terry.
Absolutely, you can. And Vocation, they have their conference is a live in person as well as a online conference, eVocation. Theirs is specifically business related, and I do believe you can get just as much information as you can. You miss out on, you know, the touch and feeling people and seeing people and that type of community, but they still have a great online presence. They have socials, they have great information, they have chat boxes so you can put your questions in and chat. So absolutely, I think that if you can't get to an in-person, then an online conference is definitely the second choice for sure.
And I want to co-sign on that, but I also want to say it's a little different. We have very short attention spans these days. And one of the difficulties with online, and I do a lot of workshops and whatnot online, so I'm not saying no, but I'm saying you really need to discipline yourself to pay attention. Don't let the cat, the dog, the wife, those distractions, somebody calling you on the phone. Yeah, maybe there's some emergency you have to handle. Okay, I get it. But all too often, it's just, somebody else is reading and I'm not in the room, so they can't really see me. I've turned off my camera and now my mind is wandering, and you start to miss things.
Yeah.
Leave your camera on. So you know they can see you. So you're more likely to pay attention. And pay attention. Get the distractions out of the way. Make sure you're in a nice, quiet room that people aren't coming in. Let them know beforehand, I'm going to be doing this thing from this time to this time. Don't bug me. Unless you're going to bring me a glass of water. Let's see. DF Raisin again here. Will there ever be a time in the future that you would consider coaching on British and African dialects and accents for voiceover? Great question.
I love that question, DF. Gosh, I will consider it. I will consider it. I will consider it.
Well, let me ask you this. How did you learn your American accent? You probably picked up your African accent from your parents and your British accent. Hey, you just grew up there.
So about 70% of information that we get in England is American-based. The American popular culture in Britain is massive.
We have infected the world.
You have. And so, all the TV shows, movies, and so, you know, cartoons. I would always sit in front of Dungeons and Dragons was my very favorite cartoon of all time. And I actually met one of the characters, and we're really good friends now. And it's just, anyway. And so I used to sit every Saturday and just mimic every single character's lines and just try to, you know, do the whole thing. And I told my mother, I said, you know, I'm going to go to America. I'm going to live in America. I'm going to be American. And so, yeah, I just kind of I loved the accent. I just loved. So then I married an American and moved to America. And just tried to pick it up just by hearsay.
I think sometimes if you are, you know, engulfed in this accent all the time, after a while you begin to just speak that way. You can be kind of infected with the accent that way. I always found I did better with accents if I've immersed myself, if I have friends who have that accent, or I can just Okay, I'm going to watch some Australian television for a while, or watch some African shows or something, and pick it up by listening and imitating. Although there are people who can do the whole phonetic thing and try to learn that way. It has never worked for me, but I know it does work, and it can be a good way to learn.
And then there's some great dialect coaches.
Yeah.
There's here at my disposal. I know Tom Antonellis is one I
Tom's one.
hear. So
And he
yeah.
we'll have him. I don't remember what date exactly, but Tom will be on later this year. Oh, got a
Oh,
question
good.
here. Oh, at 7 o'clock. Oh, doggone it. Janice Johnson Hunter, Galena, what things do you take into consideration when looking for representation? Do you have a checklist of what you look for in an agency? Another good question.
Hi, Janice. Thank you. Great question. Yeah. So basically, where do I want, what do I want out of VO? What my genre is that I'm looking for, and who works on those genres? I look on the agent's website and see if there's a place for me, or if I believe that I could add to what they have there that might be a little bit different. And so it's very important to choose your agents wisely, because those are the people that are going to really help, get your career to where you want it to be. If you're looking for a really great commercial agent, if you're looking for an agent who's into gaming and animation, and then of course there's the locations. Not all agents, some agents are exclusive only, or some agents will work with other agents too. So there's a lot that you have to kind of ask yourself into in terms of what you want with your business, in your career, what you're looking for, and then find the agents that match up with that same line of business so that they can help you move forward.
I'm going to say this too about agents. Difficult to get, more people knocking on the doors than the doors are opening for. But a friend of mine works all the time. His agent closed their doors. He asked me if I would recommend him to my agent. I did, and they got back to me and said, "Well, we have several of his type, despite the fact he's got a great record. Nope. Well, we're not going to bring him on." That happens a lot. If they have a number of people in your type, that might not happen. But what I really want to say is develop that relationship. If you get a note back that says, "No, not right now," thank them. And when you've booked something else, when you've taken another class, send them a short note. Let them know what you're doing. Create that relationship, even if it seems like it's one way for a while. And resubmit your demo from time to time. People come and go at agencies, and if you get that meeting with them, A, know you're going to be reading some copy cold, so you better be ready to go. And B, ask them questions, interview them just like they're interviewing you. You don't want to sign up with an agency that isn't getting the kinds of auditions that you want to do. Not all agencies are created equal. Some focus more on these areas, some on that. Some do it all. I'm fortunate to be with an agent that does it all. But make sure you know what that agent you're trying to get with does. Can I keep you for just a couple more minutes? We had some really good questions come, and oh yeah.
Absolutely.
Saudi voice. If you're starting out in VO, what would you recommend as a good conference to attend in the first 1, 2 years of getting into VO?
So, I would personally say for me would be a bigger conference that just has a lot of content that I can choose from to learn from. Again, it really depends on you. If you were somebody that would prefer a smaller conference, more intimate, and what that conference offers. What you get with a bigger conference is the opportunities to meet all the, so many people in the industry leaders that you want to get in front of, and the content that they give you. By the time you leave the conference, you should have a clearer understanding or at least information on what to do next or where to go next with your voiceover career. So for me, I would say the bigger, the better. Just because there's just so much there to learn. And then as you get more experienced, you can curtail your business to, if you want to just choose one or two genres, then you'll find conferences that are geared to, more towards that.
I think sometimes people don't know what's available in the world of voiceover. There's so many more genres now than there ever were before. So I kind of agree with your statement of go to the big conference where there's a wide variety of people in different genres that you can get. So you can kind of get a potpourri of what's available and perhaps find some things that you didn't know you would be interested in. Last one. Juana Plata, how you doing? She is a phenomenal professional and one of the most loving humans out in this world. Love you to the moon and back, Galena White, and kudos to you, Dave Fennoy, for highlighting this wonderful woman. Well, I don't think we can have a better ending than that.
Thank you so much, Wada. Love you so much, girl. Mwah, mwah, mwah.
And
Your first
that goes double for me,
amazing
Juana.
woman. Juana's
Well,
amazing. I love her back to the moon also.
there
Thank
you
you.
go. So Galena, when I asked you to do this, you were like, "Oh, why me? Oh, what will I say? Oh, I'm so nervous." Do you realize how much information you just shared, how you have touched a lot of people's lives in a positive way? Of course you have something to share.
Well, thank you so much, Dave, for giving me this platform, inviting me to speak with you. I do hope it was helpful because, that's I like to be helpful. So yeah, I was nervous. I really was. I was like, this is Dave Fennoy and I'm just Galena.
Silly girl. Well, you are very welcome and thank you because this was just wonderful. I know everybody enjoyed it. And if it even wasn't all the information that you were able to share, it was your wonderful personality. Once again,
Oh, thank
you step into a room, the lights get brighter. So, looking forward to seeing you in Atlanta.
What color
And
wig are you gonna have?
what
What color wig are you gonna have?
I'm not gonna have a wig. I don't this is all real. I grew every inch of this. I get that question all the time. Is that all your real hair? Yeah, that's my real hair. No extensions. No, I grew it all. I'm still growing it. How long is it gonna get? I don't know. We'll see. As long as I'm living, it'll be growing. But Galena, thank you so much. I'm glad to have had you on. Great perspective, great energy. And I will see you in Hotlanta.
I will see you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Galena White, and just fantastic. And if for some reason you just tuned in and oh no, it's over, no worries. You can visit my YouTube channel, Dave Fennoy Voiceover Training. All the Ask Dave Fennoys live there. So 24/7, 365, you can go back and view and please subscribe. If you are interested in voiceover training with me, davefennoy.com, hit the Study VO tab at the top and you can click on the one-to-one training. And if you want to follow me on Twitter, at Dave Fennoy VO. So in the meantime and in between time, you know what I'm going to say. Book something.